Good morning. I'm Sanford Unger, and delighted to welcome you here, or welcome you back, those who were with us last evening for my conversation with Daniel Ellsberg, to our symposium on the legacies of the Pentagon Papers 46 years later. I think Dan Ellsberg will be with us again today and will be in the audience, and I'm sure making his presence known as we go on. He, of course, is the person who made it possible for us to be here. I do want to mention that we are live on C-SPAN this morning, and we appreciate that very much. And it will be shown again. I think it's C-SPAN 3, and it will be rebroadcast at a later date or dates as well. My only role right now is to introduce Gene Meserve, our moderator, who is a veteran of national security coverage and reporting on ABC and on C-SPAN, and I'm sorry, on CNN, seen one, you've seen them all, you know. I won't do what I'm tempted to do, which is to channel the president, but I won't do that. Gene has moderated panels of this sort all over the world, and is as professional a moderator as we could get. And I'm very grateful to her for taking the time to be with us today. And she will introduce her distinguished panelists, and we'll get going. Thank you, Gene.
Great. Thank you, Sandy. And as many people have observed, what could be more timely than a conversation about leaks? We have a President Trump who is calling these leaks lowlife, un-American, and criminal. And then we have Daniel Ellsberg. Did many of you hear him last night in his speech? Yeah. Calling for more leaks, saying we need more to keep the country and the Constitution secure. We have a superstar panel here to talk about the issues of balancing national security with a free press and how that balance is changing, or Ben might argue whether there's a balance at all at this point. We'll find out. Let me introduce who's here with me. Next to me, a man who I'm sure you are all familiar with, Bob Woodward, who is the investigative journalist with the Washington Post, deeply involved, as you all know, with Watergate coverage and much more. Next to him is Benjamin Powell, now a partner at WilmerHale. He was general counsel at the Director of National Intelligence Officer under both Republican and Democratic administrations. And finally, on the end, another very familiar name, David Sanger. David, thanks for joining us. David is the national security correspondent for the New York Times. I'd like to talk about the here and now. Leak seems the inappropriate word. It seems like a deluge of information coming out of this administration right now. And if we put aside for a minute the massive dumps of information, the Pentagon Papers, Snowden, Chelsea Manning, I'm wondering, Bob and David, if you have ever seen this volume of leaks coming out in an administration. Is it unprecedented or not? Bob?
Well, I wouldn't use the word leaks. I think it's aggressive reporting. And it's the transfer of administrations that has created the environment, and a good deal of this is coming from former people. But I agree with Ellsberg, more leaks. But I think David would agree on this, there's this sense that reporters just sit around waiting for somebody to bring in a grocery cart of documents like Ellsberg did, or to call. And I think the best sources are not volunteers, somebody who comes to us, but people we recruit and go to and say, we want to understand what's going on.
Sounds like spycraft.
Well, no, it's reporting, and it's quite basic, and so there's a lot that seems to be coming out. I think, as is always the case, there's so much more that we don't know about. The whole General Flynn issue, where he came and now has departed, I think you could probably spend part of your life trying to untangle what really is going on there. So many of the issues we don't know. and we don't know the answers to a lot of the key questions.
Do you think we're going to get those answers eventually?
As Ben Bradley, the former editor of the Post, used to say, the truth emerges. Sometimes it takes decades. Sometimes it comes out rather quickly. But I think there should be a kind of repertorial patience in all of this.
David, have you seen anything like this? And what do you think's behind it? Do you think it is politics? Do you think it's fame? Do you think it's fear? What is it?
I think, first of all, it's highly unusual to see this early in an administration. I mean, usually when leaking, you have to assume that whenever there's a transition, the people who come into an administration have come out of the campaign. They believe that their candidate, the new president, walks on water at any moment, and loyalty is sort of at its highest. So I haven't covered as many administrations as Bob has. I didn't mean that as an age issue. It's just, you know.
I went to talk to some students recently, and one of them said, "What was Calvin Coolidge like?"
It was the time that Coolidge met you in that parking garage. I thought it was really great. You know?
They didn't even have parking garages. I'm not sure they had cars.
So, but it's been my experience since I got back from a happy life as a foreign correspondent and entered into a three-year assignment to Washington that is now stretched to 22 or 23, that usually administrations begin leaking after the first crew is kind of gone and a group has come in to sort of undo whatever damage the initial crew did and wants to explain to you how much more brilliant they are than the people that they replaced. And that process usually takes about 3 years into an administration. We've gotten this starting in, you know, week one, two, and three. And I think that reflects a different phenomenon that's underway here. First, the executive orders, which were really the first things to leak, the first big things to leak, were put together by a very small group of people who did not consult broadly. And because they didn't consult broadly, they made a lot of early mistakes. So we saw in the immigration executive order that nobody had thought about green card holders, and nobody had thought about long-term visa holders, and nobody thought about the promises we made to interpreters in Iraq and so forth. And then there was an order, which we still haven't seen, on detention that called for reopening the black site interrogation centers, as if there are countries around the world that are yearning to get our black site detention centers reopened. And I think those leaks were intended to go act as a warning sign to other members of the Trump administration who may not have seen the early drafts to say, hey, you're about to go walk off a cliff and you better read these drafts. And in fact, when second and third versions of them leaked, they were missing the black sites and so forth. So I think part of this was to create a new circulatory system because the old circulatory system wasn't working. So that's group one. The second set of leaks, I think, that you have seen have been just about the inner turmoil within the administration. And I think that is in part because you are watching a group of professional people who have been through these transitions before in our career, who know what things are supposed to be operating like at this point in time and recognize that process has fallen apart. And, you know, if you want to look at the prime example of this right now, look at the National Security Council. Having just gotten rid of General Flynn, and I agree completely with Bob that there's a lot that we don't understand yet about that, the NSC is basically going back to day one at this point. You've got to, actually before day one, they're going to have to go create themselves as if you were starting the transition. Now, that may be okay if we run on autopilot as long as nothing goes wrong between now and the time that they all come together. What are the chances of that, just given the pace of events around the world? So I think the second set of leaks is sort of a warning that things have got to get together.
You keep saying leaks, though.
And you're right. They are. Bob is absolutely right. These are not coming to us. These are we're going at. The executive orders might be slightly different. I think those flowed out. Everything else we're discussing is coming out of hard reporting.
Are you concerned at all about this, Ben, as someone from the national security side?
It's a bit of a vicious cycle because what is the reaction when you see drafts published, when you see them leak? Well, the reaction is not necessarily, okay, well, let's make sure we're consulting broadly and widely and sharing these to get input. Often the reaction is, let's draw the circle even tighter, which then has the negative effect, of course, of not being able to consult more broadly. So it is not as if it is an unalloyed good, because often the reaction, of course, is people go further and further into the bunker and say, you know, everyone's going to leak every draft that I'm going to put out there, so we'll only do it among us three people here, and we'll dribble it out. And I saw that in 2009 with some of the executive orders that were happening then, where there was kind of last minute coordination, and you know, those of us who were in the intelligence community, you know, called up and said, you know, I know you're going to sign this in an hour, but let me tell you what the impacts are going to be if you sign this in the next hour. And then there's always that scramble to fix things. So it is not as if the reaction, having observed this many times, is, okay, let's do this more broadly. Oftentimes it causes people to, you know, go further into the bunker. Because if you go through the whole process, and there's this feeling then in the White House that everything that we give to the interagency is going to go straight to the press, it just makes it more difficult and gives you more of that bunker mentality sometimes.
But this, what's going on is not about executive orders. What at bottom it is, I think, is about the power of the presidency. And is it functioning? There is this, now the first month into the Trump administration, people are mostly opinion columnists are writing, you know, it's kind of over, you can't put it back together. And I suspect when the history of the Trump administration is written, this first month is not going to be that important. The president has extraordinary powers. And you know, David and Ben know this so well. A president can do all kinds of things and is going to be measured by what they do. And in the national security area, the president can do, really start a war, as we, I mean, legally. I remember talking to a group of academics some time ago in the George W. Bush administration, and they said, well, no, the Constitution says Congress will declare war. The last declared war was when? World War II.
Yeah.
And I think we've had a few since then that are undeclared, and they were just kind of literally reading the Constitution, and I said, look, George Bush can invade Mexico tomorrow if he wants. And somebody stood up in the back and said, don't give him any ideas. But the president can employ the force as he sees fit. The only thing Congress can do is take away the money. And once the troops are out there, and if it is a reasonable military excursion, Congress is not going to take away the money. So I'm interested in what Trump is going to do as president. That's going to be the measure. And all of this hand-wringing, I mean, the first month has not been great, but what are those key decisions in the areas that are real serious national security, not things on paper?
David, do you want to jump in?
Sure. First of all, I think Bob's right that the first month will not be seen as terribly important unless it portends a continued sort of level of chaos. If he gets it together in the next 6 months, everybody will sort of forgive a first month of chaos or forget about. If he doesn't, it will end up looking like they got off on the wrong foot and didn't get back on. What strikes me as interesting in covering this administration is it has not been a straight line in any ways. There's been nothing linear about covering these folks. There are some things that they have done spectacularly badly, and we've just run through a list. And then every once in a while, they've executed something in the traditional way. So let me give you two examples.
Nomination.
The Supreme Court nomination, whether no matter what you think of the nominee, he's eminently qualified. They rolled it out well. They
coordinated
were
with the Hill.
They coordinated with everybody. It was sort of the model of, you know, how you used to go do this. And it was George Bush, who was usually pretty orderly about these things, that when he tried to nominate his own in-house White House counsel for the Supreme Court without any of that it collapsed on him. So I think it is worth considering the fact that we have seen moments where they could put it together. What strikes me in the foreign policy arena is that we have gone from what then-candidate Trump said to me and Maggie Haberman during our two foreign policy interviews with him about Japan, about South Korea, about China, to what were much more traditional encounters where right off after saying that he would negotiate on the one China policy, he gave that to Xi Jinping because he recognized that nothing else was going to happen with China if he didn't reaffirm the one China policy. His meeting with the Japanese prime minister was as boring and uneventful as every other past meeting with Japanese prime ministers. And you wouldn't have bet on that based on what he
had
said.
Except for that little meeting out on the patio at Mar-a-Lago.
Right, and that came out of a North Korean launch, and it came out of the fact that they were trying to figure out, was this a intermediate range launch they didn't have to worry about, or was this the ICBM that we've all been waiting for? And once they came to the conclusion that it was the intermediate launch, they went back to having dinner with everybody else who was having at Mar-a-Lago. So I think what they will be measured by is their first big test. So when you think back to the Bush administration, back the days when I was a White House correspondent, the first 9 months of George Bush's administration was about sort of everything and nothing. And then 9/11 happened, and it became the sort of clarifying moment that defined what kind of president he would be.
And defined, in fact, this whole century.
That's right.
Almost everything that's happened is connected to 9/11.
Absolutely, including the movement of counterterrorism to the center of American foreign policy, which it was in the Bush administration. We saw Barack Obama try to move away from that, and I think he did so somewhat successfully. And we are seeing President Trump try to move it back to the center again.
Do you think that it's going to be tougher and tougher to get information out of this administration, both because of the tightening circle that Ben mentioned, and also perhaps because some of that professional class that you mentioned, David, will be leaving this administration, perhaps of their own choice, perhaps not of their choice?
You know, I think it depends on whether or not the president figures out how to make good use of the professionals in the bureaucracy around him.
Well, word this morning that a lot of the professionals at the State Department, for instance, have just been told to pack their bags.
Right. The ones on the seventh floor who sort of do the coordination between the secretary and come together. But the fact of the matter is that any president discovers over time that the United States government is a huge enterprise and cannot be run like a small family business. And you have a president who has run a business, you can argue about how successful it has been, but it's been very small and very tight. And I think he's discovering that the techniques that worked so well at the Trump organization do not work here. There was no vast bureaucracy or intelligence community that could go work out another agenda.
But in the real world of reporting, what the headline from the press conference that Trump had yesterday really is where he said he called the Justice Department and said, let's look at these leaks. And again, back to the power of the president and the Justice Department, if they want to go look at leaks, they can really do this with an aggressiveness that we, you know, there was much criticism of Obama, and David got caught up in this, their effort to try to prosecute and stop leaking, but the power of the FBI to come in and really examine that, if those are the orders, and Trump is right, technically, some of this is illegal. And we would argue it's transparency and it's desirable, and I think generally the press is pretty careful about going through something that may be sensitive, but that may come down on our heads in a real serious way. No, David?
I think that's absolutely true, and I think, you know, one of the, while we all noted that the Obama administration did more leak investigations than all previous presidencies that we could find.
By three times.
Combined, yes. They did, by and large, stay, with one exception, to investigating suspected sources, and they didn't come after the reporters. And in the case that Bob referenced, which was my reporting on the cyber attacks on the Iranian nuclear program, Operation Olympic Games, they did a vast set of interviews with more than 100 people who they thought, you know, were potential sources, but they never did come after the New York Times, its notes, and so forth. I don't know whether...
Which they could do.
Which they could certainly do.
And you would fight it, and maybe you win, maybe you lose, but...
We don't know if the Trump administration is going to adhere by those same rules.
Exactly. And, I mean, Ben knows this so well. The power to do that is awesome. No?
Well, yeah. I mean, there will be, of course, there were rules put in. There's rules governing the issuance of subpoenas to reporters. Those could be changed by the Department of Justice. Those are largely, you know, internal guidelines. It's not a statute. It's not in the Constitution.
Could be changed overnight.
So could be, yep. You know, could be changed. And there are people that's, you know, would probably favor that, particularly in the realm of communications intelligence. That is the one place where there are federal criminal laws that say the leak of communications intelligence that's properly classified is a crime. That is different.
Not just the publication.
Exactly.
Exactly.
Yeah. Exactly.
I know one of the subsequent panels is going to get into the legalities. I don't want to delve too deep in there, but it leads me to my next question, which has to do with anonymity. The Washington Post, at least, is using Secure Drop. Is the Times using Secure Drop as well?
We've got a portal within the Times site. You can all find it on... advertised on our homepage.
In case you have documents you want to pass along.
Right? into which people can drop things in a secure way. I've never seen sort of anything like that because it runs, I'm in the same school that Bob is in, which is that these things happen by getting out and trying to understand policy and getting people to explain what they're doing or understanding their objections to what is happening. And that's usually how we find these things. But I have, and so when the Times came up with the idea of putting in the Secure Drop, which I think the Wall Street Journal has now also done, and so forth, I thought, well, you know, 99% of the stuff you get in there is going to be crazy. And maybe 90% of what you get in there turns out to be crazy. But some of it's pretty interesting. And what you discover is that there is a vast bureaucracy out here that feels that they're feels an existential threat.
And not just a national threat.
Could I ask Ben a question?
Yes.
So I'm somebody in the government, and I come to you, now a private lawyer at WilmerHale, right? And I come to you and I say, I have documents and information I want to give the New York Times or the Washington Post. How would you recommend that I do it?
Well, first, I'm going to have to do a conflicts check to see if I can represent you or not. But getting past that, let's make sure we're differentiating between two things, because there's a big difference, right? So there's the the drop of things about policy in the environmental area, or the vastness of what the federal government does, where for whatever reason you're giving things to the press.
That would be unclassified.
Normally. That would be unclassified government information. We're not going to get into the legalities of that or the appropriateness of that.
And I should say that's the vast majority of at least what, I don't see everything that comes into that drop, but that's the vast majority of what does.
Mm-hmm. So what we're talking about here, though, is let's talk about national security information. And are you dropping classified information?
Yes, I've got a boatload of stuff.
And
they say you're one of the experts on this. And you're going to say you're conflicted out?
No. But I just want to make sure we get our arrangements in place. As a lawyer, you're coming to me as a lawyer, so I am certainly going to tell you about the laws that are on the books, right? So there's no, we can talk about what the likelihood of prosecution is, we can talk about what the precedents
are. So you're going to scare me and tell me not to do it.
I am ethically bound to properly advise you that there's a statute about the dealing with communications intelligence, dealing with national defense information, and that you could be subject to criminal prosecution.
And so then in the end, I'd say,
you could
say,
also lose your clearance.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're not going to be working in the national security community anymore. There could be ramifications to
and
your
And so your bottom line clearance. Recommendation would be, don't do it.
Oh, I don't know that it would be a bottom line recommendation, but I'm certainly going to make sure that you have the full facts as a lawyer. But that's what you would expect, right? If you're going to a lawyer and you really want to hear what the possibilities are, I mean, people have gone to jail and are in jail for this right now.
No, people come to lawyers for protection. And I would want you to tell me how to do this in a way. I mean, suppose it's really, I've got something very important to the national interest. Mm-hmm. And you, even looking at it, say, this should come out. How can I do that in a protected way or not?
So you want me to help you to violate 798 and pass communications intelligence and to use my experience to do it in an anonymous and secure way? Is that
basically, yeah.
So now I'm before the DC bar for aiding and abetting you. Is that the next step?
So I've gone to the wrong lawyer.
You've gone to the wrong lawyer. Okay. You might have picked the wrong lawyer.
If Ellsberg came to you, you would probably talk him out of it.
No. I think there's the kind of advice piece of this, but there is the fact. I mean, any good lawyer, you certainly wouldn't want your client to be surprised when you go and visit them in the Federal Correctional Institute. That, hey, you didn't tell me. I thought. I read about these other guys like Ellsberg, and they get to go on panels and be treated as a hero. How come I'm sitting here in 20 years in jail? You didn't tell me that. I thought I was going to get all these awards and get to appear with Bob Woodward. And now I'm sitting here in jail and you didn't tell me. I mean, that would be highly, I don't know of any lawyer actually whoever may advise somebody to go ahead who would not make them aware of the severe of the risks of going ahead.
I mean, and if Bob asked you, what about secure drop, will that give me anonymity? You're a cyber guy now. Tell us, is it truly fail-safe?
I don't know of anyone who works in the cybersecurity field that would say that any particular method is fail-safe. There's a lot of pieces that go into transmitting documents and other things that are involved. So the fact of the matter is that you would have documents in some fashion, and you would be placing those in the hands of a third party, and you don't know the security of that third party. So relying on, the security of one particular method has its own risks.
Ben, you told me over the phone that you thought that the interplay between national security and the press had changed 180 degrees. Since the Pentagon Papers. Explain what you meant.
Yeah, I would say there was the Pentagon Papers to the era of the internet and the balkanization of the media. So it probably was stable for a long time in terms of a certain number of networks and newspapers that invested in this area and there were regular discussions when topics would come up. Now, of course, you have just the publication of raw material without any type of responsible reporting on it. You just have, you know, what's happened with WikiLeaks and Manning, the dumping out hundreds of thousands of pieces of material, names of people who are democracy activists, names of people who have been helpful to the United States. You know, there's been negative consequences to that. So that is very different, I think, in the past, where you would see an article and there may be discussions between the government and the newspaper and at least some of the more responsible places that would say, if you can show us harm, you know, we're not interested in just putting out the names of sources, the names of technical methods. So let's have a discussion about that. And you've seen that in the past. Now, of course, you have a couple of things. You have the internet in which you can just people will just dump these things out there. And now you have the widespread solicitation that both have talked about of the material. You know, come and bring us the material. That's not good reporting. That's, hey, we're like WikiLeaks. Here's our Dropbox. Drop it on in. Give it to us. So you have the newspapers moving towards WikiLeaks type solicitation of classified information. And the fact that you can't have those discussions anymore in a responsible manner and have any confidence that it's going to hold there. And
even with organizations,
somebody else will.
Okay, but an important question, I'm sorry, is this solicitation with these drop boxes, would that make us participants in a conspiracy to release classified information? In other words, if the Post came to you and said, should we have this Dropbox? Because I could conceive of a scenario of somebody dropping something in there that's really sensitive, that causes some sort of catastrophe, and the government, particularly the government now, says the Washington Post is complicitous and this is a conspiracy because they have this Dropbox.
Mm-hmm. I've not seen any legal case like that.
What
or
would
theory
your recommendation
that?
Be?
You know he's cautious.
I don't think I've seen any theory like that to date, or I've certainly not looked at it.
David, you wanted to weigh in?
Yeah, let me just disagree for a moment that that the media of the kind that Bob and I work for are doing what WikiLeaks is doing. Yeah. The collection side may look similar if you've got this Dropbox, although the fact of the matter is most of our reporting is in the traditional way one does reporting. What WikiLeaks does is take this material in and then dump it all out. And they dump it all out and have, by and large, unedited, without thinking very much about the motives of the people who dumped it in, and without interpretation. That's not what we do. We may get this material in, and I'm guessing that the vast majority of it never sees the light of day. Some of it may fit into a broader interpretive piece of journalism of the kind that you're expecting the New York Times and the Washington Post and other media organizations that you want to go subscribe to go do. And you know, the example from this actually comes from the WikiLeaks operation on the State Department cables, which I was involved in when we were doing these in 2010, and which we published as a series called State's Secrets. So we had about 250,000 cables that came from WikiLeaks, and we built our own sort of search engine and databases to go sort this through. And in the end, we wrote that series from maybe 150 of the cables. And only then, from putting a huge amount of reporting around what we were learning from those cables, and only then from going to the government in a, what was a fascinating encounter or a series of encounters with the State Department and the Obama White House, so that we were sure that we weren't publishing when some dissident was going into the Chinese embassy so that they could match it up with their cameras and throw them in jail. I had a moment when I got a call from a very senior official in the U.S. government who said, David, we were getting ready to publish one of the pieces about Gaddafi in Libya, and Gaddafi was still in power. This was about 10 months before he was thrown out of power. This person said to me, you know, David, I didn't know this till 10 minutes ago, but one person mentioned incidentally in the cable, just in passing, has been an asset of the United States, meaning working for the CIA, for years, if not decades. And if Gaddafi sees his name in a cable, he's just going to put him up against the wall and shoot him. And I said, fine, we'll take it out. We got the Guardian to take it out. We even got WikiLeaks to take it out. This was a different era, right? And as far as I can tell, he's still walking around, and that's more than I can say for Mr. Gaddafi.
So does the 24-hour news cycle, this constant churn, constant deadline, does it make it more difficult to give that sort of time to an investigation? Because someone else is going to publish.
It can, because the competitive pressures are out there, and sometimes you just have to go out and say, folks, we need to calm down and slow down and figure out what we have here. And I've been at work on one project for the past 7 or 8 months. It's a little hard to get away with that in this modern churn world. And the churn sometimes slows down the ability to go spend the time on the kind of investigative things that Bob and I and many other journalists like to go do.
And you've got a culture of impatience and speed, which drives the readers and the viewers, and the expectation is, Trump has his press conference yesterday, and I found myself going to the New York Times or the Post or other websites. Well, what's the reaction? I want instant reaction.
Twitter's where you go.
Well, I don't even know what that is. Sandy Unger sitting there, who did the great book on the Pentagon Papers and the press, the papers and the papers, wasn't it called?
Yep.
And how really important the Pentagon Papers decision by the Supreme Court was to journalism, and how liberating it was, because in that decision, which was technically a 6-3 decision, but there was a per curiam issued by the court that Chief Justice Berger, who really dissented, but he read, saying, oh no, the press can go ahead and publish the Pentagon Papers. That created an environment. David was mentioning, you're working on something and you go to the government and say, hey, look, we have this, and it may be sensitive and secret, and we want to find out if it's true, we want to put it in context. I think that at least I'm sure David and lots of people would agree that you don't want to publish something that's going to get somebody killed or thrown in jail. So you have to be very careful. So I can think time and time again, going to the 7th floor on the CIA, going to the Oval Office and presenting information that we have. And you can do that knowing you're not going to be arrested. And knowing, in a more important way, that the government is going to not say, gee, you've got this, we're going to court to stop you from publishing it. So I think it's been, I know it's been liberating to the press. Is it to the government?
Liberating in the sense of being able to engage in those discussions?
Yeah.
Well, of course, it's been helpful to have. I mean, there's been a number of occasions where, you know, those discussions have been helpful. Now, it is, but let's be clear, it's not a joyous and good day when you get the call and they say, we have this information, we'd like to come in and talk to you, like, say, at 3 p.m. today, because we want to publish it at 5 p.m. unless you could sit down and have a discussion. Or so now I have a situation where classified information has been blown, there's a source, there's a program, there's something else that may be very valuable to us. And often the case is you're doing repair around the margins.
Well, you should have found another line of work if you were looking for joyous.
Exactly. you're making it seem as if it's a we go, we have this discussion, and all is worked out, and all is fine. What we're doing is often you're trying to minimize the damage, but there is
well, but
to
you're
be
given that opportunity be, because of the Pentagon Papers decision, don't you think?
Why is it that the Pentagon Papers
gave Because otherwise we wouldn't walk in the door for fear that we would be walking out in handcuffs. So, you know.
What would, in that sense, well, yes. You know,
and that's not a joyously good day.
That's
right. So, I mean, there's a reason for this process. And the reason for this process is that if we're walking in there, it's to say, look, we have this story. We think it is important and raises the following big policy concerns for the United States, big moral concerns for the United States, whether it's the wireless, the warrantless wiretapping thing, or whether it's the use of cyber weapons by the United States against another state for the first time and the precedent that it sets. And what we're trying to get at is the concept that you can have a vigorous discussion about the policy implications of a hugely important program for the United States without necessarily blowing the how of how it's done. And you know, the example here really is in nuclear. Most analogies to nuclear weapons don't work, particularly I find, and I write a lot in the cyber field, they don't work in cyber, but one does. We had a very vigorous discussion in this country about how and when we would use nuclear weapons without publishing most of the details of how you build them, who's got authority to go use them, where we keep them, and so forth. Some of that's gotten out over years, but it's been 70 years and it's leaked out over time. That debate turned out to be critically important because United States policy reversed. I mean, MacArthur wanted to use the bomb against the North Koreans and the Chinese. We had some crazy generals who wanted to blow up the Soviet Union during the Cuban Missile Crisis, and Kennedy listened to them and escorted them out the door. We ended up concluding we would only use nuclear weapons as a matter of national survival, complete opposite from the Eisenhower, it's just another bullet in the arsenal, which we don't even think Eisenhower himself believed. Okay, so we need to have that debate in a range of different areas. Cyber's one of them.
And can I give an example?
Sure,
I mean, just because I think this...
Sure. I want to get to question shortly, but go ahead.
Okay, but I mean, real quickly, this was in the first month of the Carter administration, 1977, learned that King Hussein of Jordan was on the CIA payroll. And so I called Jody Powell, who was the new press secretary for Carter, and I said, understand King Hussein is on the CIA payroll. What's your comment? And the code, I remember vividly, the code word for the operation is no beef. And I remember Powell saying, no shit. and then he did some checking. He said, okay, the president wants to see you and Ben Bradley in the Oval Office tomorrow morning at 9:00. So we went and went through, and Carter said, I want to talk off the record. And Bradley said, fine, but I had my notebook out. And he said, no, you can't even take notes. Okay. And he said, off the record, that yes, this is true. They hadn't told him about it. He thought it was wrong to have heads of state on the CIA payroll, and he was going to stop it. And then Ben asked the critical question, if we publish this, will it harm the national security, which ultimately is the measure? And Carter said, no, it won't, but I really don't want you to publish it. Georgia, please do us a favor and don't publish this. And of course, we published it, and he was quite upset that we had. But he opened that door by saying it's not going to harm the national security. And ultimately, that's the question you're asking when you go to the government, and I think is no.
That's right. And sometimes in that conversation, uncomfortable as it may be for you, you work something out. So when I was working on Olympic Games on the cyber story on Iran, I went to many people in the government. A lot of this has now come out in court papers, so I'm not revealing anything here that hasn't been before. And I said, look, the story's got to be told. I mean, cyber is the first weapon that was developed by the intelligence community, so nobody really wants to talk about it because the intelligence community doesn't. But we've got to air how we're going to use this. If there are techniques that you think are particularly damaging because you're using them right now that I'm describing here, tell me that, and maybe we can figure out a way to word around that so we're not undercutting ongoing operations. And in the end, that's what happened. Now, Snowden, as it turned out, blew a lot of those techniques 9 months later, but we didn't know that at the time.
Ben, do you think they get it right or do they get it wrong?
Oh, I think this leads one to think that this is a process in which in all of these occasions, there is a considered and measured approach of the type that's being described by very, very senior and distinguished reporters here, okay? These same situations, though, and we can then, you know, draw a chart and start to have a fight about, well, what about this one, what about this one? The New York Times blew a very important financial program. The article was written in a manner that's suggestive of widespread illegality, turned out to be entirely appropriate based on unclassified subpoenas, no discussion with the government or consideration
of the
New York Times.
This
involved the terrorist financial tracking program, widely discussed, entirely appropriate, entirely damaging what was done there.
And as you point out, unclassified.
That doesn't mean that it was the right thing to do or that did not have damage or that the article was written in a way that was entirely suggestive of sinister and illegal activity. It was a number of other that have been discussed and published about the of in the papers.
I think
we're presenting a situation where, as if in each case, here's the process that's followed, and these are antidotes. But there are, for every one of those, let's not pretend there's not antidotes on the other side or stories on the other side. I could go down and talk about other things that have been published in terms of technical
details. What's the worst in your knowledge that was published that caused the most damage to national security?
Oh boy. I'd have to give that one some thought.
While you do that, let's start taking some audience questions. We have one right here. We have a couple of people with microphones. They're going to run a mic to you right here in the second row. Here it comes. And if you could tell us who you are.
Yes, my name is Peter Gluck. There were several references to the Pentagon Papers case in the context of a shield or a protection for media organizations. But that was 45 years ago, and the court has changed so much, not just in terms of the people,
completely,
but in terms of the ideological distribution of views. So what confidence do you think media organizations should place that the Pentagon Papers decision would continue to protect them today?
I mean, real quick, I mean, the court, it's all the justices, all nine for the Pentagon Papers decision are dead. And so they're not on the court, believe it or not. of course, it would be different, but the precedent here can change, absolutely. But see, under this, to me, is not a legal argument. That ultimately, if the press is in the position, like I think New York Times and the Post and others were on the Pentagon Papers, that this was in the broad national interest that this be published and that it actually did not harm national security, it helped national security. And as you point out, Ellsberg is kind of a hero. And so I think we have to proceed with that assumption. The difficulty here is if something gets published, which is so likely that really does harm national security or get someone killed, then the press is in the position of being on the wrong side of the line. And the Supreme Court, having done a book on this a long time ago, is inclined to look at what is the moral atmosphere, and that doesn't drive the decision, but so it's very important that we be careful, particularly in the Trump administration. But David points out in the case he was involved in, the government was very careful in subpoenaing. You finally got subpoenaed.
No, I never did.
Oh, you never did, didn't
never
you?
Did.
They wanted you to testify voluntarily or something.
They never subpoenaed us.
See, but I mean, that's a kind of sensitivity to the First Amendment that would quite likely not be practiced by the Trump administration. So we need to be careful, as we always have. It's always good to say, when we told the world that King Hussein was on the CIA payroll, I think it did not harm national security, and it was in the context of, you know, what's the CIA doing? What are they up to? What is their mission? What are they trying to accomplish? And Carter's position was it was not right for us to buy heads of state in other countries.
David,
two quick points on this. First, when we published WikiLeaks in 2010, there was considerable internal discussion in the Times about whether the government would seek to relitigate the Pentagon Papers case, and we were sort of prepared for the moment. In fact, I think we presented it to the government the Monday before Thanksgiving in 2010, and we knew we were going to publish the following weekend. And the thought had occurred to us that some of the courts might be closed over Thanksgiving. Now, we hadn't planned it that way, but it was certainly a factor that we thought would be a disincentive. The Obama administration made no effort to go out and do that in the end. Secondly, Bob makes the point that the Pentagon Papers certainly did a huge amount to inform the debate about the Vietnam War. And if you go back and you read the Pentagon Papers today as a history, and you think about the kind of things that have been leaked, whether it's WikiLeaks or Snowden today, the Pentagon Papers looks more innocent in some ways because it was backward-looking.
Historical, yeah.
Whereas it was historical material, whereas much of the material that has come out since has been operational to this day and raises, therefore, I think, a different set of issues. This process that we discussed of going to the government, I agree with you. You know, this works when it's the New York Times and the Washington Post and the Wall Street Journal and AP and others coming in the door who are established journalistic entities, and the White House will come in and have that discussion. Where I think it gets more worrisome is a lot of stuff that just leaks out in over the internet, gets published on the internet by people who either don't have the journalistic standards or wouldn't be able to attract the conversation, you know, to have that conversation at all. And if I was the government, I'd be more worried about that than I would about the Times and the Post and others.
Another question. Right here in the blue.
Hello, thank you for speaking today. My name is Chandra Caldwell. There's a clear distinction that I don't feel is being made, and you alluded to a little bit, Mr. Powell, in the sense of a distinction between revealing information of a dysfunctional White House or Department of Defense and revealing classified information, which is classified not because of the content necessarily of the information, but the sources, means, and methods by which it's collected. And we're seeing a distinction between the Pentagon Papers, which it was a very surgical approach to a singular issue that was felt to be important, compared to a Chelsea Manning or Snowden, who is releasing terabytes of information without going through it and surgically taking out information that they deemed should be shared, and the sources, means, and methods that we rely on for our national security are being released to foreign adversarial governments. And it seems like between the talk yesterday and today, that's being conflated a little bit as being equal to each other. And it's setting a dangerous precedent in my mind that you're going to have armchair analysts who are assuming that they should reveal whatever information they have access to because they feel that it's justified. And I'm curious what your response is in the changing environment.
Who wants to tackle that one? Ben?
I thought it was well said. but this is an important distinction. Some of what we're talking about here is exactly kind of bigger policy issues. I do think we're overlooking the fact that much of what we read about today, and frankly since 9/11, has been far more operational and technical details, a fascination with intelligence sources and methods, how terrorists are tracked, how counterterrorism operations are done. And there's no doubt that there's a public interest in many of the programs and other pieces of that that has been discussed in the newspapers. We've had public debates on them. We've had laws that have changed. We've changed collection authorities and really had a very vigorous debate about that. At the same time, though...
And would that have happened without the disclosure, you think? And would we have stopped listening to Angela Merkel's cell phone or closed those black sites had it not been for the revelations?
I'm not going to talk about anyone's cell phone. I don't know what would have happened with the black sites with or without those revelations. So I do think they would have been closed without those revelations, but that's a longer discussion. But we have had damaging leaks of technical sources and methods, and what you're reading about in the paper is not the Pentagon Papers and what's been kind of our global policy towards the Muslim world. And here's a study from the State Department discussing that, and it's classified because it contains some intelligence in it. We've seen a lot of discussion of, frankly, pure sources and methods of how we carry out operations, how we do sensitive electronic surveillance. And so when you're regularly reading about these things, it does have damage. And it is not just confined to the WikiLeaks of the world.
Okay, but sometimes we don't publish.
Absolutely.
To give an example from the Obama administration, going to the CIA with 10 things I had that was going to be in a book, Obama's Wars, and went through them and listened to their arguments and got to one called the counter-terrorist pursuit teams. The CIA had a secret army in Afghanistan that was under CIA control, the best Afghan fighters, very effective. And I said, I'm putting this in the book. And the CIA position was, oh my God, that's secret. That's the classic secret army. You shouldn't put that in. And I said, well, I'm not going to name any members of it or where they operate from or any operations. No, still, you should not publish it. And I said, well, look, there are a lot of people in the Obama administration who say we don't need 100,000 troops in Afghanistan, that this counter-terrorist pursuit team actually does the job, and I think it's relevant. They were not happy, but it was published, no harm. And then I got to another item and mentioned it, and literally the CIA said, if you publish that, we can lose a war. And that got my attention and went through their argument, and it's not in the book. And it's a great story that someday can be told, but you listen and you, it's David's point, you go through, and this is just much disclosure, more disclosure than the government would like almost always, because they would say don't publish any of this stuff. But not the sort of thing that will get people killed or cause us to lose a war.
So what's fascinating here about this discussion, though, is it is the reporter who's doing this weighing.
Driver.
So this is just a curious feature of the system that we have.
It's called democracy.
Well, I'm just saying, exactly. Right. Okay. Exactly. Well,
right.
No, but it...
That a single citizen can go and the government will listen to that.
Right.
Are you worried about the power that journalists might have?
I would be concerned as to whether or not the reporter has the qualifications and the full global picture of you're making decisions on what sources and methods in your judgment are going to ultimately harm the national security. You're weighing the government's argument. You're weighing what you think is the public interest. You're weighing your paper's interests. And that power is now in your hands because of information that you've obtained.
It's called the First Amendment.
Okay, absolutely. And that's what distinguishes our system. And it can work. I mean, we held for 3 years, at the Bush administration's request, a story that ultimately we were able to go publish once the program was done about a secret U.S. program to help the Pakistanis secure their nuclear weapons. And a convincing argument was made to us by very senior members of the Bush administration that to go publish it at the time that we had the story would be to give the Taliban, you know, arrows into the most vulnerable nuclear sites within Pakistan. And we held it and held it and held it. And finally, some set of events came up, and I called in and I said, you know, I'm not sure we're going to be able to hold this much longer. And they said, oh, you're still holding that story? Oh, you could have won that a year ago. That program's done, okay? I was like, oh, wish I had checked more often. But that said, yes, the distinguishing feature here is that it's the news organizations that make the decision. And that's actually not only what separates our democracy from non-democracies, it's what separates ours from, say, Britain.
Right.
Do we have another question?
And you're uncomfortable with that at core.
So what you're saying is that the First Amendment has wiped away the statutes for the protection of classified information. And I'm not saying that I'm uncomfortable. I'm saying we need to recognize, though, that it is, to the extent that the position is that we will do the weighing, and it is our power to do that. That is an awesome power.
Yeah.
That is an awesome power
but
to
you
decide.
You have an awesome power with those laws that you can go after someone who releases classified information, right?
Well, I guess we can debate about how awesome those really are in terms of the precedents and those types of things, especially if you take the position that the First Amendment wipes away all those laws.
No, it doesn't wipe them away.
I want to get another question in here. Young man in the third row right here, can we? Or fourth row? Right there.
Thank you all for speaking. I'm Christopher Blair. So far in the discussions, I'm kind of getting the feel that in the court of public opinion, we're kind of delegating the media as the prosecutor. So, and thus, ethically speaking, where does the media draw the line when receiving documents from a potential leaker? And is the intrigue of the story more important than the potential ramifications to imminent or longstanding national security policy or posture?
That's an excellent question. And I hinted at it before about why we have these conversations. Because what we're trying to do is air the issues, the policy questions. Do we as a nation want to have these black sites? Do we want to do bulk collection and so forth without necessarily blowing the operational detail? And that's, you said prosecutor. I don't think that's the case. We can't prosecute anything. We can start a policy discussion. We can make sure that discussion happens. In the end, Congress gave the president and the executive branch many of the powers that President Bush took upon himself in routing around the FISA court. But that happened only after a full discussion about whether or not that was the right way to go. So I think that what we've learned out of all of this, and what we've learned really in the era since the Pentagon Papers, is that it's very important to have that conversation so that we understand that something we're about to publish could cost a life, cost an ongoing operation, cost an imminent operation. And I don't think most people in responsible media want to go do that. But that also means that we have to make a judgment about whether the broader discussion about whether we're heading in the right direction with a set of policies gets aired. And there's a way to go do that. There's a way to go move through that line. Now, the point's been made that in the world of the internet, where everybody's a publisher, not everyone's going to show that judgment. And that's certainly one of the big challenges of our time.
We should also take a position of humility on this, and I think Ben would agree with this, that, for instance, the WikiLeaks stuff, which the New York Times had and published in that series, which I thought was very good, but as you know, almost all of that information, and I think maybe all of it, the top classification was secret.
The lowest level.
Mid-level anyway, but not the top secret special access program material. And the New York Times editor took the position, we're telling you how government works. Well, that was an excellent series, but it didn't tell you how government worked, because the top secret information is really what informs a president's decisions. And I remember talking somewhat recently to somebody about Snowden, a very controversial figure, and this person who I've known very well said, Snowden didn't have the good stuff. And I think that's true. I think that,
that's
you know,
right.
we worry about WikiLeaks and secret documents and some of the stuff that Snowden revealed. But the good stuff, the really deep secrets, as President Obama called them, don't get published normally. It's very rare. So we're getting into the government's business and an important part of it, but there's also the deep secrets part that we really don't get into. Is that fair?
I've certainly seen a number of things published in the newspapers, putting aside Snowden, that have been the details of technical operations. So I don't think that the papers stick to just here's how the government works or the policies. I have certainly seen discussions of operational details.
No, but there also, say there are X number of operations that are really sensitive. It's a very small portion that get published. Is that correct? Or
yeah. I would say that when you publish the technical details have been damaging. I've never looked to see. I mean, when Jim Clapper says only God knows all of the compartments that are out there, probably is a smaller proportion.
A compartment is a classification in a special access program or SCI program that where they're limited, allegedly, to people who have a need to know.
Yeah.
But I still think there are a lot of things we don't know about, and quite frankly, from my point of view, I'd like to know about them, because the government's capacity to do things in secret is immense, and it's really, I think, secret government is the thing we should worry about the most of all of the things, and the judge who said it got it right. Democracies die in darkness.
Well, this is a fundamental challenge of having an intelligence community in a democracy, right? I mean, this is the fundamental challenge, that the secrecy can be inconsistent with democracy.
And how do may you strike have that many joyless days.
Exactly. I'm not there, so I'm fine.
Okay, there's a question way at the back there.
Hi, Gabriela Munoz. I just wanted to go back and talk about WikiLeaks. Basically, over the summer, it was very controversial when WikiLeaks published the DNC emails, Hillary Clinton's emails, John Podesta's emails. How do you guys feel in terms of legality, in terms of trusting of the source, between WikiLeaks and, say, someone leaking from within a government organization or within a campaign? Do you guys feel that WikiLeaks is needed to get the information that sources won't reveal?
Anybody want to?
Well, I'll take a first shot at that. To my mind, the material that was released by WikiLeaks this summer, first about the DNC, and then the second tranche was the John Podesta emails, and there were some others in between, but those were the two high points, were more fascinating to me for what it said about who was trying to act and disrupt an American election than the contents. And the contents of the DNC material was largely infighting within the DNC about support for Bernie Sanders versus Hillary Clinton. I didn't find that to be quite as fascinating as many of the political insiders inside the Democratic Committee did. The Podesta emails, again, wasn't full. It had no classified information. There, you know, you got a sense of what Hillary Clinton's speeches to Goldman Sachs were like. They were a lot like speeches I heard her give when she was Secretary of State. There wasn't in there a whole lot that was terribly remarkable. What was remarkable was the fact that there was a channel from Russian intelligence to WikiLeaks and Russian intelligence distributing this first through some other channels that weren't as successful, weren't as widely read as WikiLeaks, that told us a lot about the Russian operation.
But we didn't know that.
Well,
that early.
We learned it pretty fast, yeah, Bob, because by July, we were writing stories. Remember, the first revelations, the first publication was fairly early July. And by the third week of July, we wrote a story that said that U.S. intelligence had concluded with high confidence that it was the Russians who were behind all of this. The intelligence community came out with that assessment on October 7th. So within a matter of weeks, we pretty well put it together.
Yeah, but it had an ambiguity about it, I thought. And inevitably, you're going to go to the content. What's the content of this? And those were legitimate stories. But I agree with you. In retrospect, when you have the much harder conclusion that the intelligence community made, that this was part of an operation to hurt Hillary Clinton, and there was not, over the summer in the campaign, the kind of clarity.
As you said earlier, this reveals itself over time. And, yeah. You know, we had a team that was pretty well just focused on the Russian part of the operation, even while we were reporting the materials from...
Yeah.
I'm curious if anybody's ever tried to punk you. So I come from the world of television, where we always had to be cautious about things that had been photoshopped or otherwise manipulated. Given the fact that video can now be manipulated with great sophistication, audio can be, voices can essentially be reprogrammed to say something different than they originally said, and documents certainly can be edited, have you ever gotten material that you thought was the real deal and then discovered wasn't? Someone was trying to play you?
You know, I think it's an increasing issue. Fake Twitter accounts.
Yes.
Are a significant issue now. And you've really got to slow down and say, there was a moment somebody was faking a Twitter account they had set up for Rex Tillerson. And we were looking at it and thought that he had issued a policy pronouncement until we realized this was an unverified account. Within cyber, a big issue is data manipulation generally, and it's increasingly possible to go do it, and it's something I think we have to be careful of in a way that I'm not sure even 5 years ago was possible.
And I tend to believe in human sources, that if you have somebody who's in a position of knowledge and you have established a relationship of trust, that's so much better. Even going back in the 80s, I remember Bill Casey, the CIA director for Reagan, once saying, it's so much better to have a human source, somebody who sits outside the prime minister's office who will tell you what goes on, than having a bug in the prime minister's office, because you're going to get stacks of transcripts and you don't know what's important. And I think this is the problem with the internet and the things, David, and Twitter accounts and so forth. They're guides, but in the end, what you need is somebody who will really kind of, for good reasons, tell you what's going on. And ultimately, you want to get a cabinet officer or somebody in charge of one of the intelligence agencies or a national security advisor or the president himself or herself who will respond. I, in doing books, would send questions to Presidents Bush, Obama, and just because I had the luxury of time, I can kind of say these are the 60 things that happened that are important and what's your comment on them, and they will, in all cases, I have found, engage in that because it comes from human sources, not Twitter accounts.
Questions? There's another one back here towards the back.
Hi, I'm a Georgetown student. I was just wondering, do you think that this discussion with the government is going to be possible when they view the media as this opposition party? And if that, especially with the upper echelons of government?
a really great question because, you know, every administration has to go through a period where they have to get accustomed to this kind of give and take and ask the question, do we really need to answer these? What are the consequences if we don't answer these kinds of questions, if we don't engage in this conversation? In past administrations, not in this administration yet, it's early yet, I've had people say to me, I'd love to talk to you about whether or not this piece of information would be harmful, but if I had that conversation with you, I'd have to discuss classified material, and I can't, you know, get into that. So every administration's got to work out its own set of procedures for this. It's very possible that this administration, with its rather unique view of what the media is, the opposition, may decide that they're going to engage in a very different way or not engage at all. But I think the danger for us is viewing ourselves as the opposition instead of viewing ourselves as the people who are sent out to go do a very specific job that's the same job we've done with past administrations, Democratic or Republican.
And, of course, the administration won't speak with one voice.
Of course
not. And there are many people out there who you can establish relations with, hopefully, who will explain what's going on. And I think, ultimately, the media, we have to make as strong an argument as we can for transparency and the benefits of transparency. It's not just that it helps more subscribers for the newspapers or the websites and
although
so
forth. Although that's a nice benefit.
No, but it helps the government. And if you spend enough time with people, I've had so many people in government over the decades say, you know, it was good that that got out, that we had a public discussion about it. And initially, often the reaction is one of a seizure or a joyless day, but once things proceed, they'll say, yeah, it's good that we had a discussion of the black sites. That this, I mean, this raised all kinds of governing questions, also all kinds of moral questions that needed to be discussed, and that's one of those stories that served a real purpose. And if you asked President Bush, George W., former president, and had him here on sodium pentothal, truth serum, I think he would acknowledge that, yeah, that was painful, but we needed to have that discussion.
One thing that struck me rereading Sandy's book the other day was that the Post and the Times, although competitors, stood together in a way with the publication of the Pentagon Papers. I'm wondering, in this current environment with the splintering of the media, and different points of view, whether you have that unity of effort. You have Breitbart, for instance, right now, although you may not like them, tremendously influential, joining the Trump chorus, decrying leaks to the media. So is the press position weakened because the press is splintered?
It's a really interesting question because you do have this group of loyalists out there. I think the Times and just to watch the Times and the Post in the past couple of weeks, there's been obviously no cooperation between the two groups, but there has been, I think,
common cause.
There has been a remarkable amount of incredibly good journalism done by both organizations, and I think that I think both organizations remain competitors and competitors with an ever widening group of other publications, I think that's been a really good thing.
But you can't work in concert.
You can't work in concert.
But what you can do, and this is, and I agree, this is evident in the last month, when a news organization, whatever it is, has a good story that another news organization is following, there is that line, this first appeared in the New York Times.
Yes.
And there's more and more of that. And I think the distance prevails. People are going to do their own work, but the acknowledgement of a good story, and there have been a lot of good stories, and I think it's that the New York Times is more frequently than the Post had to say, by the way, this appeared in the Washington Post.
I'm staying completely out of this one.
Wise move.
We'll take the scorecard question offline. But I think where the cause is where it's important to have the cause in common is if a government decides to take steps that, in the view of many in this room, would try to restrict free press. And I think on that question, that's where you want to see as much unity as you can, and not just the Times and the Post, but across as much of the journalistic community. Now, in the fractured world we're in, you're not going to see that entirely. And if this administration starts going after reporters or news organizations, my guess is that Breitbart might take a different view of this than the Times and the Post would. But I think that you can be fierce competitors on the news and have a relatively common view of what the fundamental liberties are here.
And the real headline from Trump's press conference in these first 4 months, whatever it has been, he made very clear that he's going after leaks. And he thinks the problem is not the information in the leaks, but the leaks themselves. So I would say keep your seatbelt on. And David, I promise to bring you a sandwich.
Oh, thanks.
In jail.
And in the show of that unity.
Would you like to pre-order?
Yeah. In the show of that unity, I too will bring Bob something as long as he emails his choices. Yeah.
Do we have another question? Any hands up out there? Here, over here, we have one. For the microphone.
Hi, my name is Andrew. I'm a Georgetown senior. My question is, at President Trump's press conference yesterday, he spoke about fake news versus real leaks. And I was wondering if any of you have a comment on how he views the difference between what his concept of fake news is and how that relates to the leaks that he perceives as a real threat to his administration.
Well, I was mulling over that line and trying to go figure it out. So wind the clock back all the way to October when he was reading out from WikiLeaks documents that he had, which were not classified, that he had read from the Podesta emails and so forth, that came from inside Hillary Clinton's campaign or among her top aides. And then contrast that with what he said in recent days. And his view of the importance of leaks seems to have changed. He said the words, "I love WikiLeaks," in October. I haven't heard those repeated in recent times. But I think what's happened with the phrase fake news is it has been adopted in part by this administration, but certainly by many of its supporters and by many others, to decry any piece of news that they do not like or find not credible. Now, in the case of these leaks about General Flynn, in the end, he's the one who decided for cause, whatever that cause was, to dismiss General Flynn. So he must have concluded that some of the data, which we ultimately got and used to explain all of this, was actually true. So I wasn't quite sure what he meant by that phraseology.
It's a term that muddies the waters in a way, because if you parse what Trump was saying, essentially saying these leaks are true, but he considers the reporting on them fake news, and that is just inconsistent, and it's one of the issues there. But the idea that you, and this is the mystery to be pursued, and that is what actually happened with Flynn, because Trump said, "Oh yeah, I would have supported him. I would have had him have these conversations." If you think about it, those conversations, at least as reported now, don't seem criminal or particularly unusual. If somebody's national security advisor about to become that, have that job, and you talk to the Russians, obviously sanctions are a key issue. Apparently he didn't say we'll make a deal. He said we'll revisit it. I think totally reasonable. So why was he fired? And that question has not really been answered sufficiently, in my view.
Before we wrap up, Ben, I wanted to give you a chance. Had you thought over the question from Bob about the worst case?
Wow. Wow. That's a tough one, because you then inevitably get into confirming things that you can't talk about.
That's the reason I asked it.
Exactly. And that's why he's a legend. You know, but certainly there are things. You know, I mentioned the terrorism financial tracking program, TFTP, and the value that provided to the country. So there are, you know, public examples out there. I won't say that's the worst one I ever saw, but there's certainly, you know, public examples of things that have happened out there that I think where the balance has not been struck perfectly.
Final thoughts on Pentagon Papers legacy. David, do you want to start?
Sure.
I think it was foundational to everything that we do. I was still working my way out of, I think, elementary school or junior high school when Pentagon Papers happened.
Oh, be quiet. We don't want to hear that.
So I would hardly be an expert on all of it. But I have to say that from what I've read in history, I think Bob had it exactly right when he said that if it had not been for that decision, I don't think we could have gone on to do what it is that we go do today. And I think that one of the big concerns we have is whether or not, rather than building on that decision, we are seeing the pendulum swing and seeing erosions of it. And that would worry me the most.
And even in that decision, the Pentagon Papers decision, in a book on the Supreme Court, Scott Armstrong and I did decades ago, we looked at at some of the documentation and interviewed the people about that decision. And Alexander Bickel, one of the great lawyers, argued for the New York Times in that case. And Bickel had the wisdom to realize that the famous Near case from the 20th century said, you can't have prior restraint, but it is quite possible that the government could stop the press from print publishing sailing dates and troop numbers. And so it's not absolute. And so Bickel argued that to the court. In this case, no prior restraint, but of course it's not absolute. And Hugo Black, the great First Amendment justice, was just enraged by this, and he came back to his clerks and he said, even the New York Times has a lawyer that doesn't believe in the First Amendment, because as far as Black was concerned, this was absolute. And if you dig into the legal intricacies, which maybe you have, it is not an absolute right. And there are things like sailing dates and troop numbers that clearly Supreme Court precedent says the press cannot publish. Is that right?
Yes. I mean, but it is foundational in terms of changing this balance, and the fact that what the government would often be interested in is stopping the publication. And by changing that in terms of basically saying the difficulty of a prior restraint really fundamentally was a shift. And that's what leads to these conversations and other things. So it puts the government in a place where it's kind of like, well, this is out there now. Are we going to go after the press? What is it that we're going to do? That's very different than what I think, you know, some in government would want to do when something comes up like this is, well, you know, darn it, let's go into court and stop that. And of course, if you were to do that, you're facing, you know, a huge, huge burden where you'd have to be something very factual, like this is the war plans of what our troops are going to do in this city on Saturday. And this is where facts matter. Bob alluded to this a little bit earlier in terms of whether there would be, you know, a case, what the court would do. And that was one of the questions. Facts make a huge difference, even in Supreme Court litigation. It is not just a broad philosophical argument. What those underlying facts are, and one of the reasons is, of course, the Pentagon Papers is not sailing dates of the ships. It is not, here's our deployment of how we're protecting troops. You know, how the facts matter and how those cases
and so if there's a next case in the future, let's hope the New York Times gets a lawyer who believes in the First Amendment.
I don't know if he's going to be calling you, though, Ben. Thank you all very much for joining us here today. Really appreciate it. And thank you for being a great audience. Good questions.